like to sing a song about the American dream. About me. About you. About that special feeling we get way down in the cockles of our hearts. Maybe below the cockles. Maybe in the subcockle area. Maybe in the liver. Maybe in the kidneys. Maybe even in the colon. We don't know. I'm just a regular Joe with a regular job. I'm your average white suburbanite slob. I like football and porno and books about war. I got an average house with a nice hardwood floor. My wife and my job, my kids and my car. My feet on my table and a Cuban cigar. But sometimes it just ain't enough to keep a man like me interested.
Oh no,
no way. No, I've gotta go out and have fun at someone else's expense.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. I drive really slow in the ultra fast lane while people behind me are going insane. I walk around in the summertime saying, how about this heat? I'm an ecto.
He's an asshole.
I'm an ecto. Sometimes I park in handicapped spaces while handicapped people make handicapped faces. I'm an ecto.
He's an asshole.
Ranting and raving and carrying on. Maybe they're right when they tell me I'm wrong. Nah, I'm an ecto. I'm an ecto.
If you want the biggest asshole.
Know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna get myself a 1967 Cadillac Eldorado. Fucking pink with whale skin hubcaps and all leather cow interior and big brown baby seal eyes for headlights. Yeah! And I'm gonna drive around that baby at 115 miles per hour, getting 1 mile per gallon, sucking down quarter pounder cheeseburgers from McDonald's in the old fashioned non biodegradable styrofoam containers. Yeah! And when I'm done sucking down those greaseball burgers, I'm gonna toss the styrofoam container right out the side, and there ain't a goddamn thing anybody can do about it. You know why? Because we got the bombs, that's why. Yeah! Two words. Nuclear fucking weapons, okay? Russia, Czechoslovakia, Romania, they can have all the democracy they want. They can have a big democracy cakewalk right through the middle of Tiananmen Square, and it won't make a lick of fucking difference because we got the bombs, okay? John Wayne's not dead. He's frozen. And as soon as we find a cure for cancer, we're gonna thaw out the Duke, and he's gonna be pretty pissed off. You know why? You ever taken a cold shower? We'll multiply that by 15 million times. That's how pissed off the Duke's gonna be. I'm gonna get the Duke and John Cassavetes and Sam Peckinpah and a case of fucking whiskey.
You know, you really are an asshole.
You shut up and sing the song, Chris. I thought I was the asshole the whole time it was him. What an asshole. I'm an ecto. I'm an ecto.
He's the world's biggest asshole.
A-S-S-H-O-L-E. Everybody, A-S-S-H-O-L-E. And I'm proud of it.
Ladies and gentlemen, due to illness, tonight the part of Dennis Leary will be played by Dennis Leary. And now, please welcome Dennis Leary.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, and fuck you. There's a guy, I don't know if you've heard about this guy, he's been on the news a lot lately. There's a guy, he's English, I don't think we should hold that against him, but apparently this is his live stream because he is going country to country. He has a Senate hearing coming up in this country in a couple of weeks, and this is what he wants to do. He wants to make the warnings on the packs bigger. Yeah! He wants the whole front of the pack to be the warning. Like, the problem is we just haven't noticed yet, right? Like, he's going to get his way, and all of a sudden, smokers around the world are going to be going, yeah, Bill, I've got some cigarettes. Holy shit! These things are bad for you! Shit, I thought they were good for you. I thought they had vitamin C in them and stuff. You fucking dolt. Doesn't matter how big the warnings are. You could have cigarettes that were called warnings. You could have cigarettes that come in a black pack with a skull and a crossbone on the front called tumors. And smokers would be lined up around the block going, I can't wait to get my hands on these fucking things. I bet you get a tumor as soon as you light up. Doesn't matter how big the warnings are or how much they cost. Keep raising the prices. We'll break into your houses to get the fucking cigarettes, okay? They're a drug. We're addicted, okay? I'm a little hyped up tonight. A little hyped up. Smoked a nice big fat bag of crack right before the show. I'm only kidding, folks. I would never do crack. I would never do crack. I would never do a drug named after a part of my own ass, okay, folks? Kind of a personal guideline in my life. Somebody says, you want some crack? I say, I was born with one, pal. I really don't need another one. Thank you very much. If I want the second crack, I'll give you a call. But for right now, I'm sticking with the solo crackola. Thank you. If I want a fart in stereo, I'll just call up and get that second fucking crackola. But right now, the big guy's fine with the solo fucking crack. Thank you. God, crack. Only in America would a guy invent crack. Only in America would there be a guy that cocaine wasn't good enough for, you know? One guy walking around New York City back in 1985 going, you know, that cocaine's pretty good, but I want something that makes my heart explode as soon as I smoke it, okay? I want to take one suck off that crack pipe and go, now I'm happy I'm dead, the ultimate high. That's the problem in this country. People are never satisfied with stuff the way it is. We gotta make it bigger and better and stronger and faster. Same way with pot. For years, pot was just joints. And then bongs came out, and bongs were okay too. But then bongs weren't good enough for some people. Remember that friend in high school wanted to make bongs out of everything, making bongs out of apples and oranges and shit? Go one day and find your friend going, hey, look, man, I made a bong out of my head. Put the pot in this ear and suck it out of this one. Good, take a hit. And they graduate to those big giant bongs, gotta start up like a motorcycle, put the pot in. Kids are driving their bongs down FDR Drive. Pull the bong over, man, I wanna do a hit, pull it off. What was the problem with just smoking a joint, eating a couple of Twinkies and going to sleep? Was that a problem? They say marijuana leads to other drugs. No, it leads to fucking carpentry. That's the problem, folks. People getting high going, wow, man, this box would make an excellent bong. This guy's head would make an excellent bong. Relax. That's why I stopped doing drugs in the first place. Not because I didn't like them, because I didn't want to build anything, okay? I don't do illegal drugs anymore now. I just do the legal drugs tonight. I'm on NyQuil and Sudafed. Let me tell you something, folks. Forget about cocaine and heroin. All you need is NyQuil and Sudafed. I'm telling you right now, I took the NyQuil 5 years ago. I just came out of the coma tonight before the fucking show. Klaus von Bülow was standing over my bed going, Dennis, get up! There's something the matter with Sonny, hurry up! I love NyQuil, man. I love it. I love it, I love it, I love it. It's the best shit ever invented, isn't it, huh? I love the name alone. NyQuil, capital N, small y, big fucking Q. I love that fucking Q, don't you? What a great advertising idea. Put a huge fucking Q on the box. They'll get high and stare at it. The Q is talking to me. The Q is talking to me. I love NyQuil, man. Because NyQuil has never changed, man. It has never changed. All the other medicines now are doing that inner child thing. We know there's a small child inside of you, so now we have grape and cherry and orange flavor. Not NyQuil. They still have the original green death fucking flavor. You know why? Because it doesn't matter what it tastes like. You take one shot, you go, hey, this tastes like, bang, you're in the coma already. What happened? He said, tastes like, and he went right into the coma. It was unbelievable. We have reached the point where the over-the-counter drugs are actually stronger than anything you can buy on the street. It says on the back of the NyQuil box, on the back of the box, it says, may cause drowsiness. It should say, don't make any fucking plans, okay? Kiss your family and friends goodbye. Say hello to Klaus. NyQuil, 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 we love you, you giant fucking Jew. And NyQuil is the secret for all you 12-step recovery program people. Yes, all you AA people, NyQuil is the key. It's the 13th fucking step. You can drink it. It's over the counter. Drink as much as you want. Are you drunk? No, I have a cold. Same cold I've had for 2 years. I just can't seem to shake it. I'm high as a kite and my teeth are green. Merry fucking Christmas. Drugs, man. Capital D drugs. I did my share. I did my share and your share and his share. I did a lot. I grew up in the 70s. That's when drugs were drugs, man. We did them all, goddammit. We did every fucking drug there was to be had. We did them all. We did stuff people don't even do anymore. Like lewds. Remember lewds?
Ludes man. Fucking Ludes man. Call up the Ludes dude. Fucking Ludes. I think Ludes explained why we were wearing the giant flare bell-bottom pants and the platform shoes. What do you think? I think it's the only possible explanation. There we were in the middle of a sexual revolution wearing clothing that guaranteed we wouldn't get laid. Yeah, okay, yeah. People don't understand, man. Back in the early 70s, you couldn't buy anything except bell-bottoms. There were no straight pants in the fucking stores, okay? The only way you could be a cooler guy was to get bigger bell-bottoms. We used to sit around and get high and go, man, when I get some money, I'm getting the biggest bell-bottoms in history, man. They're gonna start at my neck and go 20 feet straight out, man. I'm gonna be surrounded by 90 feet of bell-bottoms. Homeless people are gonna be living under my pants, man. I'll have platform shoes, I'll be 20 feet tall. We did them all, man. We even invented a couple of drugs back in the 70s. Yeah, get this, Whippets. See, some people laugh and the others need an explanation. Get this, okay? Some kid figured this out back in the 70s, and this kid should have been involved in the space program, okay? Some kid took the time and the imagination to go down to a supermarket and figure out if you take a whipped cream can container and you press the nozzle on top just enough before the whipped cream comes out, some gas comes out, you snort the gas, you get high for 5 seconds. We didn't have MTV. We had the fucking supermarket. That's what we had. We were down there every day snorting whipped cream and hamburger. We didn't care. Put some on your gums. We had to. We had to get over that bell-bottom hump. We did it all. Cocaine, we started that. You're welcome. What a great drug that was. Hey, I'd like to do some cocaine. I'd like to do a drug that makes my penis small, makes my nose bleed, makes my heart explode, and sucks all my money out of the bank. Is that possible, please? I'd like to make this face all night. I'd like to sit in a bathroom and talk to a complete asshole stranger for 7 hours on end. Is that possible, please? With no penis and a nosebleed, where do I sign up? Take my penis away! That was the worst part about the coke, man, was being in that bathroom with that stranger at the end of the night, wasn't it, huh? Talking about shit like solving the world's problems, and the only reason you're in there is because he has the coke. That should have been a fucking sign, don't you think? I mean, if Hitler had coke, there'd be Jews in the bathroom going, I know you didn't do it. I like your mustache. Fucking Himmler. Cocaine. Yeah. We used to do eight balls. Oh, those were fun, weren't they? Nothing like getting a bunch of coke, right? That was usually, like, eight balls was usually like four guys on a Friday night. One guy at 8 o'clock would go, hey, man, let's get an eight ball. It'll last us all weekend. 4 hours later, the same four guys, let's get another eight ball. And he's like, ah, let's get another one. Yeah! Yeah! Remember having the eight ball and going to a party with your friends and only wanted to do it amongst the friends and thinking that the other people at the party didn't know you were on coke? Remember that? You come out of that bathroom, how you doing? I was like, no, too much coffee. We did it all. We did it all. We did whatever we get our hands on back in the 70s, we did fucking handfuls of mushrooms, pills, lewds, coke, whatever it was, we just fucking swallowed it, okay? That's what we did. People go, well, why don't you go into rehab? We didn't have rehab back in the 70s. Back in the 70s, rehab meant you'd stop doing coke, but you kept smoking pot and drinking for a couple more weeks, you know? Yeah, give me a case of Budweiser and an ounce. I gotta slow down, Jesus Christ. I'm out of control. Look at the size of my pants, for Christ's sake. Yeah. Because that's the big thing now. Rehab is the big fucking secret now, isn't it, huh? Yeah, you can do whatever you want. Just go into rehab and solve your problems. Isn't that the big celebrity thing? That's what I'm gonna do. Yeah, I'm gonna get famous. Then my career starts to flag, I'm gonna go on a 3-month fucking bender, okay? Coke and fucking pot and smack and fucking booze and drive over people and beat up my kids, go into therapy, go into rehab, come out of rehab, be on the cover of People magazine. Sorry! I fucked up! That's what they do, man. They go into rehab and they come out and they blame everybody except themselves. They blame their parents, right? That's the way everybody comes from a dysfunctional family all of a sudden, huh? Roseanne Barr comes from a dysfunctional family. Not Roseanne. She seems so normal to me. The Jacksons were dysfunctional. Not the Jacksons. These people give each other new heads for Christmas, for Christ's sake. I am sick and tired of hearing that fucking speech, you know? These people come out of rehab and they always have the same story. Well, you know, I became an alcoholic because my parents didn't love me, you know? And then I became a junkie because my parents didn't love me enough. And I went into hypnosis and therapy and I found out that my parents used to hit me. Hey, my parents used to beat the living shit out of me, okay? And looking back on it, I'm glad they did. And I'm looking forward to beating the shit out of my kids, aren't you?
for no reason whatsoever. What'd you hit me for? Shut up and get out there and mow the lawn, for Christ's sake. There's therapy for you, mowing the lawn and crying at the same time. The Leary kid's in therapy again. Their lawn looks great. It's unbelievable. God. I'm just not happy. I'm just not happy. I'm just not happy because my life didn't turn out the way I thought it would. Hey, join the fucking club, okay? I thought I was going to be the starting center fielder for the Boston Red Sox. Life sucks. Get a fucking helmet, all right? I'm not happy. I'm not happy. Nobody's happy, okay? Happiness comes in small doses, folks. It's a cigarette or a chocolate chip cookie or a five-second orgasm. That's it, okay? You come, you eat the cookie, you smoke the butt, you go to sleep, you get up in the morning and go to fucking work, okay? That is it. End of fucking list. I'm just not happy. Shut the fuck up, all right? That's the name of my new book, Shut the Fuck Up by Dr. Dennis Leary. A revolutionary new form of therapy. I'm gonna have my patients come in, doctor, I shut the fuck up, next. I don't feel so, shut the fuck up, next. He made me feel so much better about myself, you know? He just told me to shut the fuck up, and nobody had ever told me that before. I feel so much better now. Whining fucking maggots. Well, here's to all you people who can't drink anymore. Still tastes fucking great. I take every day one beer at a time, every beer one sip at a time. See, I think alcohol, same problem we had with drugs. Alcohol was fine if we had left it alone. Alcohol was fine when it was the four basic groups, right? Beer, gin, whiskey, and vodka, because then you had to like the taste of it, right? Yeah, you've all made that whiskey face. You know, you take a shot of whiskey, you can't help but make that whiskey face because it tastes so strong. You take the shot and you go, ah! You've seen those 65-year-old men sitting around in bars with the permanent whiskey face on? I got it. Fucking giants, huh? Jesus Christ, I don't know why Sims. I gotta get going, I'll see you guys later. Take it easy, huh? That was the whole point. If you're gonna drink it, you're gonna look that way, okay? You're gonna get that burning sensation in your chest. That's the whole fucking point. So how'd they get around that problem? They invented schnapps, the crack of alcohol, right? For all the people who want to get fucked up but don't like the taste of it, new bubblegum schnapps, folks. Two things that should not be put together, bubblegum and fucking drinking, okay? They do not go hand in hand, and you've all had that Satan schnapps experience where you're out with somebody who's drinking the schnapps, and they all drink the same way, because it's like candy going down. So that first half hour, you're just like sipping at a beer, maybe? They're pouring down that fucking bottle. I got fucking bubblegum schnapps, I'm fine. Half an hour later, driving home with the Tasmanian devil in the backseat. Like, we gotta get him off. He wakes up the next morning and his liver is sitting next to him having a cup of coffee. Going, you're an asshole. Shut up and get back in my body. And all these people quitting. Look, I think it's a good thing, AA. And the recovery and rehab. Because I've got some friends who would be dead without those programs. But you know something? Now we have a different problem. Because now they quit drinking and drugs. They're completely stressed out. And they decide to work out. Which is fine. I'm not a workout guy, but I understood Nautilus. It made sense. There were arm machines and leg machines. But have you seen these people who are using the Stairmaster? Huh? Have we turned into gerbils, ladies and gentlemen? People are paying money to go into a health club and walk up invisible steps over and over again for an hour and a half. Where are you going? I'm going up, and I paid for it, too. I can stay here as long as I want, folks. You want to go up and downstairs, move into a fifth floor, walk up on the Lower East Side, okay? What's next, the fucking Chairmaster? I sit down, I get up, I sit down, I get up, I sit down, I get up. The Doormaster, I open the door, I close. What the fuck? And I'll tell you something else right now. I have the solution to the drug problem in this country. Nobody wants to hear it, but I have it. Not less drugs, more drugs. Get more drugs and give them to the right fucking people. Because every time you read about some famous guy overdosing on drugs, it's always some really talented guy. It's always like Len Bias or Janis Joplin or Jimi Hendrix or John Belushi, you know what I mean? The people you want to have overdose on drugs never would. Like Motley Crue would never fucking overdose, man, never. You could put them in a room with 2 tons of crack. They come out a half an hour later, rock on, man. Shit, they're still alive. Fuck. They're probably going to make a double live album now. God damn it! I take music pretty seriously. You see that scar on my wrist? You see that? You know what that's from? I heard the Bee Gees were getting back together again. I couldn't take it, okay? That was the only good thing about the 1980s. We got rid of one of the Bee Gees. One down, three to go. That's what I say, folks. Yeah, Here's $10. Bring me the head of Barry Manilow, all right? I want to drink beer out of his empty head. I want to have a Barry Manilow skull keg party at my apartment, okay? You write the songs, we'll drink the beer out of your head. We live in a country where John Lennon takes 6 bullets in the chest. Yoko Ono is standing right next to him. Not one fucking bullet. Explain that to me. Explain it to me, God. Explain it to me, God. I want it explained to me now. Jesus. Now we got 25 more years. Yeah, I'm real fucking happy now, God. I'm wearing a huge happy hat. Jesus Christ. I mean, Steve Ray Vaughan is dead. And we can't get John Bon Jovi in a helicopter. Come on, folks. Get on that helicopter, John. Shut the fuck up and get on that helicopter. There's a hairdresser in there. Yeah, go ahead in there. Yeah, yeah. I don't get it. You know, I just don't get it. I missed the fucking point someplace. The boat left and I wasn't on the boat. Explain it to me. Heavy metal bands on trial because kids commit suicide. What is that about? Judas Priest on trial because my kid bought the record and he listened to the lyrics and he got into Satan. Well, that's great. That sets a legal precedent. Does that mean I can sue Dan Fogelberg for making me into a pussy in the mid-70s? Is that possible? Huh? Your Honor, between him and James Taylor, I didn't get a blowjob till I was 27 years old. I was in Colorado wearing hiking boots, eating granola. I want some fucking money right now. Let me make sure I am crystal clear on this issue, okay? Heavy metal fans are buying heavy metal records, taking the records home, listening to the records, and then blowing their heads off with shotguns? Where's the problem? That's an unemployment solution right there, folks. It's called natural selection. It's the bottom of the fucking food chain, okay? I say we put more messages on the records. Kill the band, kill your parents, then yourself, okay? Make sure you get your whole head in front of the shotgun. Thank you for calling. Thank you for calling. Let me tell you something. We need a 2.5-hour movie about the Doors, folks. No, we don't. I could sum it up for you in 5 seconds, okay? I'm drunk. I'm nobody. I'm drunk. I'm famous. I'm drunk. I'm fucking dead. There's the whole movie, okay? Big, fat, dead guy in a bathtub. There's your title for you. And I also don't go for this other thing now with MTV being so big where you get a band that gets a hit video and all of a sudden they think that they're like icons and they can tell us how to feel about environmental issues and how to vote and stuff. You know what I'm talking about? Like R.E.M. Shiny, happy people. Hey, 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 hey. Pull that bus over to the side of the pretentiousness turnpike, all right? I want everybody off the bus. I want the shiny people over here and the happy people over here, okay? I represent angry, gun-toting, meat-eating fucking people, all right? Sit down and shut the fuck up, Michael. Don Henley's gonna tell me how to vote. I don't fucking think so, okay? I got 2 words for Don Henley. Joe fucking Walsh, okay? Thanks for calling, Don. How long's your ponytail now, okay? All these rock stars should have been killed, man. Every single goddamn one of them. Right after John Lennon died, we should have gotten the Partridge Family bus and driven around and killed them all one by one, you know? Elvis Presley should have been shot in the head back in 1957. Somebody should have been walked up behind Elvis in 57 with a .44 Magnum, put the barrel of the gun right up to his brainstem and just pull the trigger so you could remember Elvis in a nice way. Huh? Wouldn't it be nice to remember Elvis thin with a big head of hair? Maybe that gold lame suit? Wouldn't that be nice? Because how do you remember Elvis? You know how you remember Elvis. He was found in the toilet. With his pants around his ankles and his big, fat, hairy, sweaty, king of rock and roll ass exposed to the world and his final piece of kingly evidence floating in the toilet behind him. Ah, creepy. One of his aides had to walk in and go, dang, you know what she did? I better flush the toilet. Oh, man, I should have saved that. I could have made some money off of that. Dang, man. A ding-dang do. That's why I'm glad Jesus died when he did. Oh, yeah. Because if he lived to be 40, he would have ended up like Elvis. Come on. Oh, yeah, he had that big entourage, 12 guys willing to do whatever he wanted to do. If he was famous already at that point. If he lived to be 40, he'd be walking around Jerusalem with a big fat beer gut and black sideburns going, damn, I'm a son of God. Give me a cheeseburger and french fries right now. Where's Mary Magdalene? I want a blowjob now. Come on now. Fuck you. I'll turn you into a leper. Give me a cheeseburger now. God damn it. Love me tender. Love me true. Empty my colostomy bag. Oh, I think I shit my pants in the last. Change my diaper now. I'm going to hell for that bit. and you're all coming with me. And don't try to get out of it. We didn't laugh at that bit, Jesus, please! Shut up, get on the bus with Larry and Scorsese, you're going right to fucking hell! And you know what hell is, folks? It's Andy Gibb singing Shadow Dancing for eons and eons. And you have to wear orange plaid bell bottoms and sit next to the Bay City Rollers. How you guys doing? This is gonna suck! I was reading an interview with Keith Richards recently in a magazine, and in the interview, Keith Richards intimated that kids should not do drugs. Keith Richards says that kids should not do drugs. Keith, we can't do any more drugs because you already fucking did them all right? There's none left. We have to wait till you die and smoke your ashes. Jesus Christ. Talk about the pot and the fucking kettle. Let me tell you something, folks. I don't need a rock star to tell me that I have to quit drugs, because you know something? I already quit them all. Yeah, I quit everything. All I have left is this. That's it. Just him and him. That's it, folks. That's all I have. Yeah, that's it. Just him and him. That's it. I love him. He's great. He's great. He's hops. He's barley. He's protein. He's a meal. But he's nothing without him. He's nothing. And I love the two of them together. They're great. Maybe their cousin Coffee comes over on the weekends. But, you know, otherwise, it's pretty much just him and him. And as much as I love him most of all because I love to fucking smoke. I love to smoke. I love to smoke. I love to smoke. I love to smoke. I smoke 7,000 packs a day, okay? And I am never fucking quitting. I don't care how many laws they make. What's the law now? You can only smoke in your apartment, under a blanket with all the lights out? Is that the rule now, huh? The cops are outside. We know you have the cigarettes. Come out of the house with the cigarettes above your head. You'll never get me, copper. I'm never coming out, see? I got a cigarette machine right here in my bedroom. Yeah, see, yeah. Know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna get one of those tracheotomies so I can smoke two cigarettes at the same time. Oh! I'm gonna get 9 tracheotomies all the way around my neck. I'll be tracheotomy man. He can smoke a pack at a time. He's tracheotomy man. I'm looking forward to cancer, man. I want that throat cancer. That's the best kind. You know why? You get that throat cancer, they give you that voice box thing. Know what I'm talking about? Sure, it's scary, but you can make a lot of money with a voice box. Get a voice box, walk around the streets of Manhattan. You got any spare change? Here's my whole wallet. Get away from me. Oh! Imagine a whole family with voice boxes. That'd be creepy, wouldn't it? They'd be out in that backyard every day during the summer. Dad, can we go to the beach? Yes, can your mother and the dog will leave right now? Sparky, come here. Or the ultimate irony, guy with a voice box pulling up to the drive-thru window at McDonald's. That has to suck, huh? Can I help you? Big Mac and a large order of fries. Stop making fun of me. I'm not making fun of you. I'm getting the manager. Get the fucking manager. I don't get it. I can remember a time in this country when men were proud to get cancer, goddammit, when it was a sign of manhood. John Wayne had cancer twice. Second time they took out one of his lungs, he said, take them both out, I don't fucking need them. I'll grow gills and breathe like a fish. Babe Ruth, greatest baseball player ever to play the game. He had a voice box. He was the first American to have a voice box. Yeah.
This is Babe Ruth. This is old Mr. Walter Bambino. I smoked 25 goddamn black Cuban cigars a day. I had meat for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I fucked 18 prostitutes a night. Of course, I'm dead now. I'm up here in heaven. Lou Gehrig's up here with me. God love Lou Gehrig. Jesus Christ, poor Lou Gehrig. Died of Lou Gehrig's disease. How the hell did he not see that coming, you know? We used to tell him, Lou, there's a disease with your name all over it, pal. There ain't no Babe Ruth disease, I'll tell you that much right now. Have a hot dog and a Hummer. Go ahead, it's on me.
I don't know. Personally, I think Billy Martin said it best when he said, hey, I can drive.
Because we tried to be nice to you non-smokers. We fucking tried, okay? You wanted your own sections in the restaurants. We gave you that, huh? But that was enough for you. Then you wanted the airplanes. We gave you the whole goddamn plane. You happy now? You own the fucking plane. I'd like an explanation about that one, folks, because I will guarantee you, if the plane is going down, the first announcement you're going to hear is, folks, this is your captain speaking. Look, light them up, because we're going down, okay? I got a carton of Camel non-filters. I'll see you in the ground. Take it easy. Actually, more like this.
This is your captain speaking. Smoke them if you got them.
The filter's the best part. That's where they put the heroin. Only us real good smokers know that fucking secret. Yeah, we tried to be nice to you non-smokers, but you just fucking badger us, you know? You won't leave us alone! You got all your little speeches you're always giving to it, too. Your little facts that you dig out of a newspaper or a pamphlet, and you store that little nugget in your little fucking head, and you see us light up and you spew them out at us, don't you? I love these little facts. These little facts. Well, you know, smoking takes 10 years off your life. Well, it's the 10 worst years, isn't it, folks? It's the ones at the end. It's the wheelchair, adult diaper, kidney dialysis fucking years. You can have those years. We don't want them, all right? And I guarantee you, if I'm still alive, then I'll be smoking. I'll be in my wheelchair with my adult diapers on and my 25-year-old non-smoking born-again Christian son behind me. I'll be going, hey, make sure you wipe this time. I was itching all week, for Christ's sake. And get me some more whippets. I'm almost out, you fucking pussy. Come on. Because you're always telling us, well, you know, if you quit smoking now, every cigarette takes 3 minutes off your life. If you quit now, you can live an extra 10 years. If you quit now, you can live an extra 20 years. Hey, I got two words for you, okay? Jim Fix. Remember Jim Fix, the big famous jogging guy? Jogged 15 miles a day, did a jogging book, did a jogging video, and dropped out of a massive heart attack when? When he was fucking jogging, that's when! What do you want to bet it was two smokers who found the body the next morning and went, hey, that's Jim Fix, isn't it? Wow, what a fucking tragedy. Come on, let's go buy some bots. It's always the yogurt sprout-eating motherfuckers get run over by a bus driven by a guy who smokes 3.5 packs a day. Sorry, officer, I didn't see him. I was too busy smoking. I love to smoke. I love to smoke, and I love to eat red meat. I love to eat raw fucking red meat. Nothing I like better than sucking down a hot steaming cheeseburger and a butt at the same time. I love to smoke. I love to eat red meat, and I only eat red meat that comes from cows who smoke, okay? Special cows they grow in Virginia with voice boxes in their necks. I tried eating vegetarian. I feel like a wimp going into a restaurant. What do you want to eat, sir? Broccoli? Broccoli's a side dish, folks. Always was, always will be, okay? When they ask me what I want to say, what do you think I want? This is America. I want a bowl of raw red meat right now. Forget about that. Bring me a live cow over to the table. I'll carve off what I want and ride the rest home. Dum da da dum da da dum. People go, yeah, but you eat red meat. It stays in your colon for 15 years. Good, I paid for it. I want it in my ass, okay? I want him to find a meat sweater from my esophagus down on my ass so when they open me up in the end, this guy's covered in meat. He's meat man. He's meat tracheotomy man. I'm going to open my own place. Open my own restaurant and get away from you people. I'm going to open my own restaurant with two smoking sections, ultra and regular, okay? And we're not going to have any tables or any chairs or any napkins, none of that pussy shit, just a big wide open black space, and all we're going to serve is raw meat right on the bone. And only men are going to eat there, naked men, sitting around a big giant campfire, and no men's room either. You have to piss, you mark your territory like a wolf. And if some guy has a heart attack from eating too much meat, fuck him, we throw him in the fire. More meat for the other meat eaters, yeah! Because you got to have goals. Because everybody in this room knows everybody who's quitting me. You don't have that friend who's quitting it. You know what I mean? The guy's quitting everything. I quit smoking, I quit drugs, I quit drinking, I quit meat, and I feel great. I get up in the morning with a nice big bowl of oat bran. I go to the bathroom for 3.5 hours. I have another bowl of oat bran. I go back in the bathroom for 6 more hours. All I do is eat and shit. I'm going to live forever. My colon is the strongest muscle in my body right now. I could pass Elvis through my colon right now. And all these cereals they have, crackling oat bran and horking fiber chunks, you know. Cereal used to come with free prizes. Now it comes with a free roll of toilet paper in every box. Guys get up on Sunday morning, forget about the New York Times. I'm gonna need the Bible. I got a big one brewing here. Dad, there's a phone call. I'm on Genesis, goddammit. You tell them to call back after the creation. People checking their own feces for fiber. You have too much free fucking time on your hands, okay? Let me tell you something, folks. You are going to eat the meat. Oh, yes, you are. Oh, yeah. You might have quit meat now, but eventually, 2 years from now, or 5 years from now, or a few days from now, you are going to eat the fucking meat. I'm telling you right now. Because you have to face a cold, hard fact that you vegetarians must stare in the face every goddamn day that you're eating vegetables. Huh? Eggplant tastes like eggplant. But meat tastes like murder, and murder tastes pretty goddamn good, doesn't it? Yes, it does. Yes, it does. And I know you don't want to eat the meat because I love the animal. That's why I don't want to eat them. Yeah, me too. I love animals. I love my dog. Oh, he's so cute, my doggy. I love him. But that's the problem. We only want to save the cute animals, don't we?
Yeah.
Why don't we just have animal auditions, line them up one by one, and interview them individually. What are you? I'm an otter. And what do? I swim around my back and do cute little human things with my hands. You're free to go. And what are you? I'm a cow. Get in a fucking truck, okay, pal? But I'm an animal. You're a baseball glove. Get on that truck. I'm an animal. I have rights here. Here's your fucking cousin. Get on the truck, pal. We kill the cows to make jackets out of them, and then we kill each other for the jackets we made out of the cows. And here's what sums up the animal rights movement to me. You've all heard this speech, haven't you? Don't eat the tuna fish.
What?
Don't eat the tuna fish. Why? Dolphins are getting stuck in the nets. What about the tuna fish? Well, fuck them. They taste good, you know. They never had their own TV show, for Christ's sake. They never swam next to our boats and made cute little sounds. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I love the little dolphin. Get out of here, you tuna fish. I'll make a fucking sandwich out of you. I love the little dolphin. You tuna fish piece of shit. Get out of here. I love the dolphin. You will eat the meat, folks, because this country was founded on two things, meat and war. You eat enough fucking meat, you want to kill somebody. That's the way it works. That was the ultimate American dream for me during that Persian Gulf War. I was sitting in my living room naked with a can of Budweiser and a 3-inch steak watching the war live on TV. I had a 6-foot erection with a giant cheeseburger on the end of it. I ate so much meat during the war, by the time it was over, 3 weeks later, I was like, no, 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 we need to keep fighting. Make a couple of stops on our way home from the Persian Gulf. First stop, Vietnam. Surprise the fuck out of those people, huh? You make a movie? Not this time, pal. Second stop, not Iraq, not Iran, not Russia. I'll tell you where. You know where? Canada. I don't trust those people, okay? They're too nice and they're too quiet and they live right above America. I think if you live in Buffalo, right in the Canadian border, and you listen real close late at night, you can hear those Canadians up there sharpening their ice skates, getting ready to come down and take our fucking cheese. I don't trust any country with that many French-speaking people, okay? Because in Montreal, in the French-speaking quarter, they treat Americans like shit. You know why? Because years ago, they gave us the croissant. Le croissant. And what did we do? We turned it into a croissant sandwich. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. You got any pate? We'd like some of that, too. Some chicken liver pate would be very nice. I don't pronounce it pate. I'm not going to pronounce that little faggly squiggly mark over the E, okay? I'm an American. I pay my taxes. It's pate as far as I'm concerned. It's like that singer, Sade. Well, my name is spelled Sade, but I pronounce it Sade. Great, my name's Dennis. I'm going to pronounce it Tefle, okay? We can all be fucking French. Pronounce your name the way it's spelled. And then you can suck on my pinier, okay? Chante un bouton, chante un bouton, chante un bouton, 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 bouton. I don't have enough problems in my life worrying about cancer and tumors and war and everything else. I have to walk into a coffee shop in the middle of Manhattan every morning and go, yeah, give me a cup of coffee, and then give me one of those, what do I say? Give me a fucking donut, okay, pal? Give me a donut with chocolate icing on top and nothing inside. I don't trust people who put shit inside a fucking donut, okay? Well, it's only hot blueberry sauce. It could be hot French semen for all I know, pal. I want a donut, chanton ponton, chanton ponton, chanton ponton, ponton. France. France, country that made Jerry Lewis famous, for Christ's sake. France. 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 What's your name, chanton? Where do you live? Pontin, Fintin, Pontin, Fintin, 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 Fintin. Wow, I'm really out of control in this French thing, aren't I? Holy shit. Wow. There was a second there where I almost left the building and took Jerry Lewis hostage. How do you say help in French? Help me, I have a big French monkey in my back. Get him off me! Whew. I don't know. Personally, I think Mama Cass said it best when she said, all the leaves are... Monday. I'll tell you something. It's tough to drink and smoke nowadays. It is. It's completely out of fashion. You all know that. You're not supposed to be a macho guy anymore. You're not supposed to smoke or drink or eat meat or any of that stuff. It's very hard to be a macho guy. Everybody wants to be a macho guy. All the presidential candidates want to be macho. We haven't had a macho president since FDR. There was a tough guy. There was a guy in a wheelchair from polio, smoked 3.5 packs a day in public. What a guy, huh? We have nothing to fear but fear itself. Yeah! Huh? And, you know, staircases, you know. Staircases, soccer, dancing, and fear. Then we're home free, I'm pretty sure. No, it's tough. It's tough for guys, you know, right now. Because in spite of Iron John and Fire in the Belly and the whole men's movement, it's tough to be a guy now because you've got to balance that macho thing. You're supposed to have all the other elements in place and the macho thing's in the background. Just a little bit of macho, you know? That's the way it's supposed to be. Because we're supposed to be involved in equal rights. We've had like 25, 30 years to get used to the idea of being sensitive guys and to kind of help women out with their equal rights. We haven't done a goddamn thing, have we, guys? No. We just sit around and wait for them to get paid the same amount of money as us. But we don't do a goddamn thing about it, do we? But I think we should get credit for the little bit of progress that we made. Maybe just a smidgen. Come on. Come on. Come on. 15, 20 years ago, we didn't care if women had orgasms. We couldn't have cared less. Now, you're going to have one if it takes us 4 fucking days, man. We don't care how long we have to be down there. Honey, did you come yet? No, let me get my toolbox. Hang on a second. Nope. This is a threat to my masculinity, goddammit. You must come. Supposed to be about tenderness, we've turned it into a performance sport, haven't we, guys? Honey, did you come? You did. I'm the winner of the orgasm cup. She came. She came. Just so we can walk into work the next day and brag to the other guys. That night was unbelievable, man. My wife must have come 15 times. Look at my jaw. It's frozen, man. It's unbelievable. Sad. And it's very difficult as a guy to learn how to cry, you know? It's one of those very tough things. The only time we can like to cry is like when a famous sports guy retires, you know? We get one tear and one eye just kind of wells up. That's the only time it's okay. Even your friends go, it's all right. It's just a guy retiring. It's not a movie or anything. He's okay. He's not wearing a dress or a bra. He's fine. It's a sports guy. You know, that's a genetic thing. I think that's so deep in men, in the DNA, that crying thing. Because we know, even we know at moments when we're supposed to cry, we just can't bring it out of ourselves, can we? We're just kind of like, oh, I'm going to cry. God damn it, I can't cry. My balls are too goddamn big, I guess. You know? Very difficult. I'll give you an example. I have a son who's 2.5 years old now. And he was born... Thank you. Applause for my son. He was born 3 months premature. Dangerously premature. He was just under 2 pounds when he was born. He was this big. He was in intensive care for 5 months. Now, the whole time he was in the hospital, every day I went to that hospital and I sat by the bed and I prayed, please, God, let him get better. Please, please let him get better. Please, please, please. He got better gradually, slowly. At the end of the 5 months, we brought him home. He was home for a couple of weeks. We take him back for his big checkup. The doctor looks him over. He goes, he's A-okay. He's going to be fine. And as soon as I heard those words, the macho button snapped back out of my head and I was like, oh. McCartney's going to be fine because my semen is so strong. That's why. Yeah. Sure, my wife gets pregnant on Tuesday. We have a baby on Thursday, for Christ's sake. I jerk off. There's a kid there in the morning. You kidding me? Sad, sad, sad. And I know I get it from my dad. I think most men get their behavior patterns from the dad. My dad was a great guy, you know? Irish immigrant, came over right after World War II. Real Ted Williams, John Wayne kind of a guy, you know? Real macho guy. He was an auto mechanic for 35 years, but he could do any job. He was a man's man. He had tools all over the basement. He could do electronics and carpentry. He was always building shit around the house. We started out with a 2-room apartment. We ended up with 18 rooms straight up into the sky and paneling in every room. What is it about Irish immigrants and paneling? Does anybody know? We had paneling on the ceiling, on the floor. My mother had a dress made out of paneling. It's like they get off the boat at Ellis Island. Forget about that freedom of speech. All we want is that goddamn paneling. That's what we want. He was always working. I remember one time, my brother's 10th birthday, my brother John, who's 3 years older than me, his real name's John, we call him Kiwi, that's his nickname, because Kiwi became sort of the label after when he was about 15, he took a hit of acid and ate a can of Kiwi shoe polish. Yeah. And he's one of the brighter guys in the neighborhood, so you get some idea of the educational level. We weren't readers, you know what I'm saying? We didn't even bother to read the labels on the shoe polish. We just ate it, you know? It was a funny tasting fucking brownie, I'll tell you that much right now. So it's my brother's 10th birthday party. We're in the kitchen, me and my brother, my mom, birthday hats, chocolate cake, singing the birthday song, happy birthday to you, happy birthday. My dad is in the living room putting up paneling for the 10 minutes we're not in there, you know. So I got 10 minutes, I'll do the whole room. And he's working with a circular saw. So this is the sound effect we hear come wafting down the hallway during the birthday party. And my dad comes waltzing into the kitchen with his thumb hanging off at the phone. And this is what he says. He goes, we got any electrical tape? I got to tape this baby up here. My mother goes, yeah, I'm going to drive you to the hospital. He would not let my mother drive him to the hospital. That was too much of a threat to his masculinity to be seen in a car driven by a woman. So he taped up the thumb with black electrical tape and drove himself minus one thumb to the hospital. I turned to my brother. I said, hey, pal, forget about crying, okay? Crying is over. We're never going to be able to cry about anything ever, okay? Our father figure is a man who could sever his own head with a chainsaw, and he'd staple gun it back on. Fucking head came off. Unbelievable. So, 2 years later, my brother shoots an arrow into my head. I'll explain how this happened. My brother's best friend was this kid, Cliffy DeCourcy, who lived up the block from us, okay? And this one Christmas in the 60s, Cliffy DeCourcy, as a Christmas present from his parents, got a bow and arrow set. Not like a fake, pretend bow and arrow set. A real fucking bow and arrow set, the kind Ted Nugent has, okay? I don't know if you remember this. Back in the 60s, parents gave weapons to kids at Christmas time all the time. We used to get guns that shot plastic bullets, the same kind they use in riots and demonstrations now. Parents were nuts back in the 60s. Here you go, son. Here's a bomb. Take it out and play with it. Go ahead. Here, take some meat with you. Blow up the whole goddamn neighborhood. Merry Christmas to you. So I'm in the alley in between the house I grew up in and the house next door, just hanging out, being a kid, pretending, playing by myself. And I see my brother and Cliffy appear down the end of the alley with the bow and arrow set. And my brother says to me, hey, Dennis, just stand in front of that garage door. We're going to play William Tell, all right? I didn't know who William Tell was. I was just so happy the older guys were playing with me. I got in front of the garage door. I was like, okay, yeah, who's William Tell? Is it me? Is it you? Is it Cliffy? And then my brother takes the luckiest shot in the history of archery. Pulls that bow back one time, and the fucking arrow lands right here in the middle of my head, right? And then my brother and Cliffy made the greatest face in the history of faces. They both made the same face at the same time. They both went like this, like that, and ran away. Remember when you're a kid, you get in trouble, you just run away. Run away! Where? Spain, Europe, run away! So now I make the long march upstairs with the arrow in my head. I'm not crying yet, I'm afraid to cry. Up to the second floor apartment where my parents are drinking Lipton tea and eating fucking scones. And I go, Dad, Johnny shot an arrow into my head. And my father looks at me like it's the most natural thing in the world. Like there's roving gangs of Indians all over the city. He looks down at me and he goes, come here. And he pulls it out. Oh, remember how much it hurt when they pulled it out? No, you don't, I'm the only fucking guy who knows. Me and General Custer are the last two white men to get shot with arrows in this country. He looks down at the gaping hole in my head and goes, just put a Band-Aid on it, you'll be fine. My mother goes, you drive him to the hospital, mister. Cut to the car. I'm on the passenger side, hole in my head, blood trickling between my eyes. I'm not crying, I'm afraid to cry. My dad, pissed off, driving me to the hospital because this is more time taken out of his paneling, you know. There was actually paneling on the side of the car. It was one of those Ford Country Squire station wagons. We're driving, he goes, does it hurt? I go, oh no, Dad, it feels great. But just stab me in the neck a few times, for Christ's sake. I'm 8 years old. Could I cry, please? I go to the hospital. I get 15 stitches and a lollipop. Oh, thank you very much. That'll fit right in the fucking hole. But the story has a happy ending. Because we got home, my brother got the shit beat out of him by my father. That was one of the great beatings of the 60s, man. Forget about Jerry Corey versus Muhammad Ali. My father versus my brother. It was over 15 seconds into the first round. My brother's on the floor, and my dad's going, how'd you like an arrow shot into your fucking head? I was like, all right, that's justice, Dad, yeah. An eye for an eye, an arrow for an arrow, yeah. I would hope you're applauding the justice on my brother's end and not the arrow in my head. Thank you. Yeah, my dad was just a tough guy, you know? Is this the way he's brought up? Just did not know pain. I went back to visit my dad when I was 27 years old. Now I'm a grown-up guy with my own place. I go back to visit him. They're still living in the same house. He's putting up new paneling over the old paneling. You gotta keep up to date, son. That's the thing, you know. And he's using a pump-action nail gun, which were new at that time. You and I'm talking, like it's like a gun, but it shoots nails. And he's talking to me, and he misfires. Shoots a nail right in the middle of his own hand. Ding-da! And I'm looking at him like, oh, my God, this is how he takes it out. He goes, oh, excuse me, son. Ding-da! And takes it out with his teeth. Jesus Christ. I'll tell you, I never saw his balls, but they must have been fucking huge, ladies and gentlemen.
Give me a hand with these balls, son. I can't get them in my pants. Christ, they're huge.
He was unbelievable, man. He smoked 5 packs a day. Didn't even have his own brand. If you asked him for a cigarette, what do you want, a Marlboro or a Salem or a Newport? This is the kind of guy, if he ran out of cigarettes, just smoke a branch off a tree. Give me a branch. Ting, tong. And then, in 1985, my dad went back to Ireland to visit the village he grew up in, his brothers and his sisters, who all still live there. He was standing in a pub in Killarney, screwed a Marlboro into his lips, lit it up, and bang, was dead before he hit the ground. That'll pop your little macho balloon. When the guy you think is always going to be the John Wayne Ted Williams guy is dead in a millisecond, and you get a phone call, huh? But that's the best way to go for you, isn't it? I mean, it's hard for the people left behind, but it's the best thing for you. One second, you're an Irish immigrant. The next second, you're face-to-face with God. How you doing, God? Got cigarettes up here? Okay. I think you could use some paneling behind Elvis. It's just my own personal. Because once I got the news, I did the thing I should have known I was going to do. I did the Irish macho guy thing. I got that news on the telephone, and all of a sudden, I got that lump in my throat. Like I was about to cry, but I never cried. I just held it in. People must have thought I was a nut at the wake and at the funeral. People at the wake coming up to me, sorry for your troubles. Held it in the whole time. Held that puppy right here. That's what Irish guys do. We hold it in until we blow up. Sometimes you hear about bombs over in London. They're not bombs. They're Irish guys blowing up. It wasn't until I had a kid, after I got married and I had my son, that's when I felt like I was doing this distorted therapy. I was taking all this stuff from my dad, and I was filtering it down to my son, and I felt better all of a sudden. And I know that's a cliche, that you change when you get a kid. I also know it's the big fashion thing of the 90s. Here's my kid, he matches my couch. But it's true. After you have a kid, there's a wave that washes over you. It might be 2 days later, it might be 2 weeks later, it might be 2 years later, but there comes a day when you look down into that crib and you go, oh my God, look at this. Look at this cold, sober, empty little vessel waiting to be filled up with ingredients, and it's up to me and my wife. We can fill them up with anything, love, or hate, or indifference. And that's when I realized, oh my God, now I know why I'm supposed to have a responsibility to the planet, because I want him to have a better life, so that maybe 25 years from now, there'll be a better world for him. I never get involved in stuff. You know, I vote, but I don't get hands-on. And now I realize I have to get hands-on to try to change the planet, so that maybe 25 years from now, he can live in a world without war, in a country without color, with clean air to breathe and clean water to drink, so that maybe 25 years from now, he could turn to me and say, you know something, Dad? I really like this place. And I could say, well, son, I did my best. And other times I think, hey, fuck him. The planet it was this way when I found it, all right? I'm sick and tired of my generation getting blamed for the state of the planet. I'm sick of my generation getting called the TV generation. Well, all you guys, David, watch TV. What'd you expect? We watched Lee Harvey Oswald get shot live on TV one Sunday morning. We were afraid to change the fucking channel for the next 30 years. This show sucks, yeah, but Tony might get shot during the commercial. Now, hang on. That's what's wrong in this country. We always shoot the wrong guys. We shoot JFK. We shoot RFK. It comes to Teddy. We go, ah, leave him alone. He'll fuck it up himself. No problem, you know? Biggest target in the whole goddamn Kennedy family. Nobody takes a shot at him. He weighs about 7,000 pounds. You could shoot a bullet in Los Angeles and hit him in the ass in Boston 5 minutes later. He'd be standing on the lawn at the Kennedy compound going, oh, there's a bullet in my ass. Oh. Ted Kennedy, good senator, but a bad date. You know what I'm saying, folks? One of those guys gets home around 4 o'clock in the morning and goes, what did I forget? Oh, the fucking girl. What's the matter with me? Jesus, where are my pants? Holy shit. Because I'll tell you, folks, we got a real problem with guns in this country. We have people snapping almost twice, three, four, five times a year, right? People just snap. They can't take it anymore. They snap. They go into McDonald's and kill 15 people. Huh? I mean, what the fuck is going on down at the post office? Every 6 months, some guy gets fired, comes back, and kills all his coworkers. If I worked at the post office as a supervisor, I wouldn't lay anybody off the next 25 fucking years. I'd just walk around going, Hanrahan, what are you doing? Nothing. Well, keep it up. You're doing a great job. Jesus. I'll tell you. And I am sick and tired of New York taking the blame in this country for the crime problem. You know, whenever you read a fact chart, it always says Detroit leads the world in rape and murder and everything else, but New York takes the blame. New York's a cesspool. It's a cesspool of filth and crime. We're moving. Hey, I just moved here 4 years ago, and I'm not leaving because this is the most exciting place in the world to live. Oh, yeah. Yeah, there are so many ways to die in New York City. Come on. Race riots, drive-by shootings, subway crashes, construction cranes collapsing on the sidewalks, manhole covers blowing up, and asbestos shooting into the sky. We had a subway crash here a couple years ago. 5 people died. The next day they found out the driver was drunk and hooked on crack. Folks, this makes Disneyland look like a fucking bike ride, doesn't it?
The driver today is Edward. He's drunk and hooked on crack. The man sitting next to you has a loaded 9mm. Good luck, folks.
Honey, get the camera out. This is gonna be fucking great. Yeah. I love living in New York, man. And people who live in New York, we wear that fact like a badge right on our sleeve because we know that fact impresses everybody. I was in Vietnam. So what? I live in New York.
Really?
Yeah, because New York teaches you to live life the way it should be lived. Moment to moment. Yes. Because every moment in New York could be your last. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You could be walking down the street tomorrow, feeling good about yourself, drink-free, drug-free, looking forward to the future. And somebody accidentally nudges their poodle off a 75th floor ledge. Poink! And he's headed for the ground at 175,000 miles per hour. And kerchunk, he's embedded in your head. You're dead on contact. The headline in the Post the next day reads, man killed by best friend. People cut the article out and they laugh about it at the office, and you're forever remembered as the Poodle Man.
I knew the Poodle Man, and he hated fucking poodles.
New York teaches you to live life moment to moment and street to street and beat to beat. Because we've all played that street to street game in New York, haven't we? Yes, we have. Good block, bad block. Ooh. Good block, bad block. Ooh. Gun block, crack block. Ooh. Asbestos block, poodle block, poodle block. Because most people think life sucks and then you die. I disagree. I think life sucks, then you get cancer. Then you go into chemotherapy, you lose all your hair, you feel bad about yourself. Then all of a sudden the cancer goes into remission, you come out, you look good, you feel good, you're going great. All of a sudden you have a stroke, you can't move your right side. And one day you step off the curb at 68th by Lincoln Center and bang, you get hit by a bus, and then maybe you die. Because I think Jim Henson said it best when he said, anybody got any aspirin? I think I got a cold. And a chill filled the room. We all have this incredible attachment to the Muppets, don't we? We love the Muppets. They're so cute. Did you hear about Jim Henson's funeral here in New York City? Huh? Huh? Kermit the Frog and Big Bird saying it's not easy being green at Jim Henson's funeral. If I'm 56 years old when I kick the bucket and a fucking sock is singing at my funeral, I'm gonna pop out of that coffin and go, hey, what the hell is this about? Sammy Davis Jr. gets Frank Sinatra, I get a fucking sock, I'm pissed off now. You know, we spend a lot of time in this show talking about death and disease and cancer and catastrophe, and we do it because, well, I think it's fucking funny. But we want to send you home now with an upbeat number, with a dance number, with a song that'll put a smile on your face and a nice warm feeling down here in the cockpit. Everything is horrible, yeah. Really, really, really terrible. I'm really depressed. I'm really downtrodden. I'm down, trodden square. The whole world is doomed, yeah. We're all gonna die. 25,672 people die every single minute. 1,650 people just died. Cancer, death, AIDS, inflation, taxes, George Bush, hell, Satan, cancer of the face, cancer of the colon, cancer of the wrist, yeah. And John Denver on compact disc. Oh, 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 oh. Solo. 17,675 more people just fucking died. Remember that guy that was sitting over there? He went to the men's room. He's dead now. You'll never see him again. He didn't even say hi to him, and now he's gone. Don't you feel bad? I'm sure you do. JFK, RFK, LBJ, FDR, drive. He said, oh yeah. Malcolm X, Lenny Bruce, the little chick from the Poltergeist movies. Stan Getz, Miles Davis, Joe Papp, Red Fox, Freddie Mercury. Fred McMurray. You know, I got a pain in my left arm. It goes all the way from my shoulder down to my wrist. I've been short of breath all night. Just kidding, folks.